Okay. Today's reading is from Hebrews chapter 11, verses 11 through 19. It was by faith that even Sarah was able to have a child, though she was barren and was too old. She believed that God would keep his promise. And so a whole nation came from this one man who was as good as dead. A nation with so many people that, like the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore, there is no way to count them. All these people died still believing what God had promised them. They did not receive what was promised, but they saw it all from a distance and welcomed it. They agreed that they were foreigners and nomads here on earth. Obviously, people who say such things are looking forward to a country they can call their own. If they had longed for the country they came from, they could have gone back. But they were looking for a better place, a heavenly home. That is why God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. It was by faith that Abraham offered Isaac as a sacrifice when God was testing him. Abraham, who had received God's promises, was ready to sacrifice his only son, Isaac, even though God had told him, "Isaac is the son through whom your descendants will be counted." Abraham reasoned that if Isaac died, God was able to bring him back to life again. And in a sense, Abraham did receive.
Awesome. Welcome back to I Will Prepare a Place for You. And so this morning, as I indicated in the welcome, that we are talking about God's place that he has prepared for us physically, that he is preparing for us spiritually in the church and in our spiritual homes, and then eternally that he is preparing for us in heaven. And so using that as an illustration for this morning, so my family and I are in the middle of moving, and the family worked diligently yesterday getting the garage cleaned out and getting the stuff over to the new house. And so one of the things that we're doing is we're trying to renovate a bathroom in order to get it ready to move into the new house. And so I wanted to kind of use that as an illustration for us in our lives and the process that God takes us through spiritually to get ready is often how we look at physically renewing or restoring or building a house, a home, a church, whatever the case may be. And so let's go ahead and go to those first pictures there. So this is the bathroom. So everybody gets to see our house this morning. So pray. God has just really blessed us. We're just so thankful. We've been renting for about almost 4 years, and we've been looking diligently in the past year. It's like, okay, the real estate market is crazy in Rochester, but God has indeed blessed us. And so this is the upstairs. It's a two-story house, and there's four bedrooms upstairs, and this is the only bathroom. So what we were looking at was that with the kids, and when Maddie comes home, there would be six people that would be sharing this one bathroom. We're like, well, we need to kind of figure something out. So this is kind of the powder room on the side with the master bedroom. And then if you go to the other picture, so this is the only bathroom upstairs that they're kind of connected. So we're like, we're probably going to need to do something about this situation if this is the house for us. So we'll just kind of include that thought in the purchase price and think about it in that manner. So we're like, okay, we're going to have to redo this bathroom. Let's try and get it done before we move in. So that was the goal. It doesn't look like that's going to happen, but God is still helping us with getting it renovated. And so you're going to see the process in that. So go ahead and go to the first picture there. Oh no, so this is the kids. This is the Polar Challenge. I just threw this in there for fun because I was looking through my pictures and I found this. I was like, yeah, this is super cool. So, we in Rochester, we had the Polar Plunge this weekend. Well, this was our polar competition. I think back in December, when Maddie was here. Might have been, was it January, early January, end of December? So what I did with the kids is I said, okay, you got to stand outside on the porch, shorts and a t-shirt, no shoes or socks on, and the longest one to survive gets $20. And so you can see Levi's the smart one because he's already inside by the time I took this picture. And then Maddie and Josiah are both cheating because they have their arms inside their t-shirts. And Lydia's just appalled. I mean, she just can't even believe to be out there. And I think if I'm remembering correctly, didn't Maddie win at like 15, 20 minutes? No? Josiah? Oh, that's right. That's why you were upset. Okay, I said that last night. So Josiah ended up winning. It was like Maddie and Josiah at the end though, right? And so Maddie kind of said, oh, finally I'm going in. And Josiah won, but then I gave everybody $20, and Josiah was a little upset about that. But you know, but they were all okay. They all got money out of the deal. Nobody got frostbite. They're all doing fine. So, anyways, I thought that was just fun. All right, I'm sorry. Keep going. So this is okay. Yes. So this is me, Josiah, and Levi. So we are actually preparing to do demo on the bathroom. So, you know, when you do a demo on something, it's a lot of work. You have to actually prepare for that. And so I was thinking about that with regard to our spiritual lives in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. It says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and see, the new has come. Everything is from God, who has reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. And so I was thinking about that in order to get to the new, that we often have to get rid of the old in order to do that. And so we actually have to submit ourselves to the process of demolition sometimes to God, to say, God, I need your help in getting sin out of my life. I need your help in breaking generational curses or in dealing with challenging things that are happening to me in my life. Lord, I need to demolish some of these things. And the first thing that we realize is that it's a serious thing. Like, you're not just going to demolish a stronghold with a fly swatter. I mean, it's not going to happen. You can't take down concrete or brick or walls with a fly swatter. You need the proper tools in order to be able to do that. And so you need the safety gear, the mask, the glasses, and the gloves, and everything, because we're talking about strongholds. We're not just talking about, you know, casual quarrel. Right? This is not just the battle of words or, you know, you're just in a verbal argument. No, God is talking about we need to demolish strongholds in our life. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 4 and 5, where it says, since the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but are powerful through God for the demolition of strongholds. We demolish arguments and every proud thing that is raised up against the knowledge of God, and we take every thought captive to Christ. So if we are to break free, if we are to get rid of strongholds, then we need to take demolition seriously in our lives. We need to prepare ourselves with the armor of God, with the helmet of salvation, the shield of faith, the sword of the Spirit, the belt of truth. We need to spiritually arm ourselves for this battle, right? We're not going to overcome the enemy. We're not going to demolish strongholds. Yes, we can serve Christ. Yes, we can follow Christ. We can have relationship with Christ. But if we want victory in our lives, if we want to actually get rid of strongholds, we are going to have to battle in order to do that. We are going to have to prepare ourselves for war because it's a stronghold. But the good news is the weapons of our warfare are powerful for the breaking down of those strongholds. So let's go ahead and go to the next picture there. So then we see, okay, then you're ready for war. Okay, then the demo begins, all right? So this is the powder room on the other side, the first slide that you saw in the yellow room. And then this was the small bath, the hallway bath on this side. And so the first step was to kind of take the wall out in between. So what we're going to do, instead of having two tiny bathrooms, we're going to have have one a little bit bigger bathroom. All right, still not huge, but it's going to be a lot more functional for the whole family. So first we're working on the wall. So me and Josiah and Levi started working on the demo. I mean, they had a blast. Josiah and Levi is like, I didn't even know this was legal to like break stuff like this. You know, they got a little sledgehammer and they were going to town and breaking tile. But it's a lot of hard work, right? I mean, it's heavy. It's you're breaking stuff. That's why you need the safety equipment. I mean, you've got to take all the tile and concrete and everything, and you've got to go put it in the dumpster. And there's a lot to it, even in a small bathroom like this. There's a lot to demo, and so realizing that it takes work to allow God to demolish strongholds in our lives. That's gonna take effort on our part. It might be fasting, it might be prayer, it might be dedication to God's word, or going through a difficult study like we're doing like right now with Breaking Free by Beth Moore. That you're gonna have to discipline yourself, and you're gonna have to actually work at it in order to break that stronghold in your life, because demolition is hard. It's not fun to have things exposed in your life, or to bring up old wounds or challenging things that have happened in your past, dealing with unforgiveness or people that have betrayed you. Those things are not fun to deal with. That is hard work spiritually. But if we want the new, if we want the renovation, if we want the brand new picture, then we're going to have to demolish the old in order to get there. Okay, and then I wanted to just kind of go through and just kind of compare some of the phases of construction with what God does in our spiritual lives. So then the next picture there, this is the demo complete. So we actually had the contractor come in and do the floor, because it was built in the 60s, and the concrete subfloor was like inch thick concrete. So I'm like, okay, you guys can go ahead and bring your little jackhammer in and take care of that, because I don't even know if we could do it with a sledgehammer. So this is the final demo is complete. You can see the floor is out, the walls are out, everything. And this is the clean slate, right? So this is we're dealing, we've demoed, we allow God to come into our lives, to take out the old, and now we're ready for the new to begin. We're ready for God to start the restoration process. And so you can see that, the first thing that they did when you're completely, you've got the floors and the walls open, is that they're going to work on your HVAC and your electric, because they need to get underneath the floor and they need to be able to get in the walls. And that's a picture of us connecting with God, right? So when we first come into relationship with God, whether it's through baptism or through surrendering our lives to Christ, whenever that is, we are connecting to the power of God. We then have the ability to become the children of God, right? God has given us His Holy Spirit. And so that's what it looks like, that after we go through that demolition process, then okay, God, you now can have your way. You can start to work on those things behind the scenes, in the plumbing, the electric, and the HVAC. All right, so that was the completely demo phase. And now let's go ahead and go to the next picture there. So this is with the subfloor and the drywall. And this is kind of like, okay, now, and I said last picture was clean slate, but this is really kind of like the restored clean slate. This is like, okay, I'm finally starting to get my groove. I'm like getting back to church. I've rededicated my life to Christ. I'm going to serve Christ. And maybe I was gone for a while. Maybe I was backslidden. Maybe I wasn't going to church. Maybe I was not serving God. I was going down the wrong path. But God, I'm going to allow you to do demolition in my life, and now I've got a clean slate. And so at this particular juncture, you can do anything you want to with this. You can pick any flooring, you can pick any tile, any lighting. It is a completely clean slate. And so we want to get here as Christians to be able to say, okay, God, here I am. I am ready for your service. Whatever it is that you want to do with me, I will do. Wherever it is that you want me to go, whatever it is that you want me to say, wherever you would like me to serve. What is it, God? What gifts, talents, and abilities have you given me that you would like me to use inside the church? Just as we receive these new members this morning and realizing that, hey, God has given them gifts, talents, and abilities, that they have something to bring to the church, just as all of us do. We all have gifts, talents, and abilities. And so, God, how would you like us to use those? How can we serve inside your house? So we want to get to that clean slate. Then the next phase would really be, and this is where we're at right now in the house. So we've got a little bit to go, but I was just going to go through the rest of the processes and kind of talk about that. The next step is really going to be the tile. And I was thinking about that with regard to discipleship in the church, that, yes, the foundation and the subfloor is down, but you really need the tile to get everything else done, because you can't put the vanity down until you have the tile. You can't put the toilet on until you have the tile. The fixtures really aren't going to go on. And so you need that foundation of the tile to be able to go in before you do the rest of the work. And so I was thinking about that with regard to the church. That's really where we're at with discipleship, that we need to make sure that this is foundational level for us. However God is going to use you, you need to think about that God has called you to make disciples. It's not just the pastor's job, it's not just the staff's job, that God has called each and every one of us to make disciples. That was the Great Commission. Go therefore and make disciples. It wasn't just to the apostles, it was for every believer of Christ to make disciples. And so however you use your gifts, talents, and abilities, you want to think in that context of how can I help make disciples of Christ. Colossians 2, 6, and 7, just as you receive Christ as your Lord and Savior, may you continue to be built up and grow in that faith, because we want to continue to grow in that faith in which we have received Christ. Okay, the next phase is really going to be the plumbing fixtures. And so after that tile is done, you know, the toilet and the shower head and the sink and those types of things, I was thinking about that's really foundational to the function of the bathroom. And for the church, that really looks like two things. It looks like the prayer spiritually, and it looks like stewardship physically. That those things are essential, and often with the plumbing, you know, most of it's underneath the floor behind the walls. And that's the same thing with prayer and with stewardship. You know, we're not posting people's giving or serving hours, and we don't often have people, you know, come up in corporate prayer and come up to the front of the church and pray. But those two things are essential to the function of the church. If you are not giving and serving, and the people of God are not praying, then the church is definitely not going to be functioning as the body of Christ as it should. And the same thing for a bathroom physically. You need that plumbing. You need that behind the walls, the electricity, those things that are under the floor to be able to work and function. Otherwise, the rest of it's not going to work. And so just thinking through that with your prayer and your stewardship, you know, we're not keeping track of those things. We're not asking you to, you know, log your hours. But it is essential that as you serve Christ, that those are foundational to your lives. Because that's what's going to allow you to grow, and that's what's going to allow the church to be everything that God has created us to be. That He can do more things through us, and He can accomplish great works through us. If we are praying and we are giving through our service and through tithes and offering, then there's not really a lot that God can't do. Right? But when we limit those things, then we actually limit God. Not because His power is limited, but His power and effectiveness through us is limited. And so we want to encourage you to continue in your prayers and in your stewardship. And then I was thinking also about the lights, that really demonstrates for us the outreach and the evangelism of the church. That, you know, you got the vanity lights and we've got a fan light and a light over the shower and stuff. It just makes everything brighter, cleaner, neater, allows us to be able to see. And that's what we want to be as the body of Christ. That's our goal, to tell people about the good news, to be the light of Christ in the community, to our neighbors, in our workplace, to be the salt and light. And then I was thinking about the paint and the trim that I was, you know, that's probably comparable to the public service and the staff. And I'm really kind of poking at myself here this morning, but thinking about, you know, as staff, we're usually up in front of the congregation and you want your trim and you want your paint, you want it to look good and you want it to, you know, be just right and you want it to work together well. But honestly, it's really not that important to the function of the bathroom, right? I mean, if you really want to talk about what's going to work and what's not going to work, and so, you know, it's, you know, we're getting ready, we're in the process of calling a new pastor, and I think that's important and that's valuable, and we want God to send the right person, but it's not like we can call a pastor so that we don't have to do our job. Right? So that we can just, we call a pastor so he can do all the discipleship and then we don't, no. That's not the purpose. That's not the point. Right? We all have to be about that because that's what's going to help us function as the church. And that's what's helping that bathroom function. It's not the trim and the paint that is making that bathroom work. It might look good, but if the plumbing behind the walls isn't working, it's not going to matter how good it looks. And so we need to remember that as we're thinking about calling a pastor, as the body of Christ, the prayers and the stewardship of the people, it's vital, not only to your own growth, but to the health of the church. It takes the entire body of Christ to be dedicated to that. And then let me end with, you know, one of the last things you usually do in a bathroom renovation is you hang the mirror. And so let's go ahead and just go to that last picture there. We did a virtual demonstration of what we're hoping that the bathroom is going to look like, so we'll see. I got this for Michelle for Christmas. It was not very expensive, but Kohler does this thing now where you can actually go online and get a design consultant, and they do like a virtual rendering for you. So we did this, and so hopefully that's going to be what it looks like. But when you place the mirror up there, I want to encourage us to think about, right? What do you see when you look in the mirror? When we've allowed God to do the demo, when we've allowed God to do the hard work, when we've dedicated ourselves through prayer, through fasting, through stewardship, through being committed to God's word, then we have to look in the mirror and we have to say, I'm a child of God. I'm a son or daughter of the King. I'm the head and not the tail, above only and not beneath. Greater is he who is in me than he who is in the world. And we have to say, there is no longer any condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Once we have allowed God to do that work in us, not that we're ever going to be perfect, but then we can look in the mirror and we're not going to feel condemned or beaten down or destroyed because we're not looking and seeing ourselves anymore. Now we're seeing Christ. Because it's God who's working through us. And so when we see God doing things in our congregation, bringing new members, or doing works through Care Portal, or whatever the case may be, then we need to have the realization, that's not us, that's God working through us. We are simply allowing God to do what only God can do. And so we look in that mirror and we don't see condemnation, we don't see guilt, we see Christ. And we want to see that as a church too. We want to see Christ, we want to see God working, that this is the Father's house. This is not the pastor's house or the worship leader's house or the president's house or the elder's house or the trustee's house or whoever's house, right? This is the Father's house and you are welcome here. Whether you are a member or not, you are welcome in this place because it is the Father's house. You are welcome in the church. It is the Father's house. You are welcome in the kingdom of God. It is the Father's house. And so maybe you felt betrayed, maybe you felt neglected, maybe you felt like you've never had a place to belong. I want to tell you that you belong in the Father's house. He has created a place especially for you. Here in this house, eternally in heaven, and also physically in your lives as well. And so as we close, I just want to play a song called I Am Who You Say I Am, Who You Say I Am by Hillsong.